I can tell you now that these vampires don't sparkle. This world is a strange one. Believe it or not, I've got some vampire stories to tell you tonight. At long last, after requests out the wazoo, I'm finally doing a video on vampire sightings. But these are not the sexy teenage emo vampires. These are completely different beasts. From a creepy stalker who thinks he's related to Dracula, to blood-sucking creatures, you'll soon learn that anything vampire-like in real life is far from tame or appealing. Enjoy these allegedly real vampire encounters. But first, I'm looking to read your stories about Jersey Devil sightings and creepy Walmart or McDonald's stories. So if you've got one, be sure to share it soon at darknessprevails.org. Thanks. Now, chow down on some garlic bread and prepare to be sucked. Number 1. Vampire in the Woods. Submitted by Daniel. A few years ago, my friend Stacy wanted to go to her dad's vacation home. It was a nice place. There was a lot of wilderness, and the house had one of those classic wood pillars holding it up, and almost the entire front half was glass, which was great because it really gave you the chance to look out at the trees and nature outside. There were tons of neat things you could do out there. You could go rock climbing, have a nice evening strolling in the woods. Her dad even had a kit for making s'mores. Unfortunately, that's not what I'm here to tell you about. I went up there with Stacy and her two friends. I'll refer to them as Emma and Ashley. I was the only guy. Now, please don't get the wrong idea. Just because I'm the one guy with a bunch of girls does not mean that I was going to try anything with them. After all, I'm homosexual. You can say that's how I met Stacy. She had a lot of trouble with boyfriends, and I had always been there to help her out. Anyway, we got there and all of us searched the house. It was a mind-blowing place. It was as cool as it was since we last came. Though there was something a little off. Something about the place felt heavy. The woods were quiet, which was weird, because the sounds of nature are the first things you hear out here. But not this time. I apparently wasn't the only one feeling it. But we ignored it, and later on we decided to go swimming in the lake. It was during the late afternoon, and I was getting ready to head back, when Stacy called me over. When I walked over to her, I noticed that Emma was crying. Immediately, I asked her what was wrong. But she was too upset to say anything. Stacy told me that they were talking and laughing, when Emma suddenly grew pale. She just remained frozen, while Stacy asked what was wrong. And the next thing she knew, Emma started crying. This was really strange. Emma was the most outrageous girl in the group. She constantly threw herself at me and rubbed her leg against mine. She teased me because she knew I didn't like it. But seeing her so startled was frightening. It was nothing like her. So we headed back before it got too dark and we settled in. Emma was now on the couch with the blanket. She had no emotion. She acted like she was in shock. Stacy and I were talking while Ashley went outside for a smoke. We were laughing about something when Emma suddenly and finally spoke up. Did you see it crawling? What? I said. We were confused and creeped out by what she just said. It was crawling on the other side of the lake. It was watching us. Still, I had no idea what she was talking about. Ashley outside began yelling for us to come out. Stacy and I went, but Emma stayed inside, eyes wide, and she began to cry again, even harder. I didn't want to leave her, but I had to see what was going on. Ashley was pointing off into the tree line. She looked spooked. I saw a man out there, peeping out behind those trees. He's watching me smoke. Stacy got angry. She's not the type of girl to get spooked easily. There's a freaking pervert watching us, she snapped, and went back inside. Soon after, she came out with her dad's rifle. She used to go shooting with him, and she was quite the marksman. We were only planning on scaring the guy away, but if anything happened, that gun would do well for protection. I'm not familiar with guns myself, so I just walked up beside her as she and Ashley went towards the bush. We walked out for a while. Ashley had the flashlight, and Stacy had one on her gun. We couldn't see anyone, and we realized that we'd gone too far. I walked a bit ahead and turned to them. We should really be heading back. I think we've spooked the guy enough. I didn't even notice them step backwards, all the color from their faces draining, and I saw Ashley start to tear up. I didn't know what I was expecting when I turned around, but when I did, I wish I hadn't. The thing, whatever it was naked. It had yellow eyes that were dinged red at the corners. Its hair was almost completely gone, and its skin was white and scabby. But its teeth, dear God, they were the most horrible thing I've ever seen in person. They were long and thin, and covered in dried blood. Stacy fired at it, and the thing bolted off. I watched the creature and didn't even realize that the girls had started running. I tried to catch up with the moving light and their cries. It was hard for me, and I eventually had to stop and catch my breath. I lost their track, and I was still terrified of running into that thing. I was close to the lake, that I knew, so I hid under the dock. The moon gave me enough light to see the water near my feet, and it slightly illuminated the trees nearby. A second later, I heard a thud on the wood above me. By this point, I was choking up, trying not to cry. I thought I was going to die. This thing stalked back and forth. I could hear it sniffing hurriedly. Though it looked more like a person, it sounded like an animal. It was looking for me, trying to smell me out. There was a sound in the trees, and this thing instantly jumped off, away. I watched it run on all fours towards the sound, and I did not wait for it to come back and finish me. I ran, not even wanting to find the lights of their torches. I just wanted to get back inside the house. I needed shelter away from this thing. I knew the way back from the lake and I found it, and all the lights were off. As soon as I ran up to the door, it flew open and Ashley pulled me in. We all huddled in the far room. We were all trying to keep quiet as we listened to this creature stalk across the front porch. We heard the doorknob rattle a few times, but it was locked. We didn't get any sleep that night. Minutes before the sun came up, we heard the porch's tile squeak with weight. Then we heard that thing rise up and jump off. We waited until it was bright outside and gathered all of our things, and we hightailed it out of there. None of us even dared to stay another day. When there were no more trees on the road around us, when we actually arrived into town, we finally spoke up. I was sitting in the back with Stacy when she turned to me and asked, "How did you get away?" "What do you mean?" I asked, finally swallowing the lump in my throat that had been there all night. "When we were in the woods, we saw that thing creeping up behind you. It was looking right at you." "It was watching you across the lake too," Emma added. My stomach set heavy. Was this thing after me the whole time? Was that why it followed me to the dock? To this day, I don't know why it singled me out. Perhaps it was my gender, or perhaps I was just unlucky. Whatever it was, I have not been back there since, and I don't plan on going back, ever. Number 2. Fanfiction Stalker, aka Son of Dracula. Submitted by Alexa Van Helsing. Let me start off by saying that Alexa Van Helsing is my Wattpad name, and I no longer have that account after this. I'm in my late teens, and I am soon going to college. I want to be a journalist or an author once I get out of school. Writing fanfiction is a way to help me relieve stress since I have anxiety, and it's only gotten worse after this experience. Now, most people believe that fanfiction.net is a place where no one can really harm or stalk you, and I'm here to tell everyone that that is a load of bullcrap. This story happened about 4 months ago, and I don't think I'll ever have another fanfiction account after this. So one day, of course, I was writing fanfiction on my account. I love writing about creatures and horror, though obviously by my screen name you can tell I love that kind of stuff. My favorite thing to write about is vampires, specifically girl vampire slayers. I even got my username from a book series I loved to read when I was younger called Alex Van Helsing, and it was written by Jason Henderson. Anyway, I would usually take requests from some people after I wrote a chapter or so. they would ask me to write something for them, and we would talk it over via private message. Now, none of these people that messaged me wrote anything threatening towards me. All in all, it had been a good experience up until this. Really, the only reason people would message me was to talk about what they wanted to see in the story I was writing. Then one day, out of the blue, I got a message from a Vladimir Dracula, which made me smile since I thought he was another vampire fan like I am. I opened the message, and I was horrified to find he had messaged me very unpleasant things, such as calling me a whore or slut. Now, I knew there would be people out there like him, so I ignored these messages. For some reason, I didn't bother blocking him, though. Looking back on it, it might have been out of fear of him doing something else if he got more enraged. Over the next few days, I got message after message all the time from Dracula, and it said the same things as the others. It was one foul word after another. One of them even told me to hurt myself, which I would never do. I just couldn't understand how some stranger could feel this way toward another stranger. What had I ever done to him? Still, instead of blocking them or reporting it, I just let it slide, thinking he would leave me alone eventually or get tired of it. And for a moment there, I thought I was right. For nearly 2 weeks, I got nothing from him, and I thought it was all over. But I was wrong, because the next week I got a message from him, and this one terrified me. He had started saying things like how he was going to hurt me, like how he knew I was a little whore, and things like that. Now, after 2 days of getting this stuff, I had had enough. But I messaged him back, and I'll admit it now, that was a bad idea. I messaged him back telling him to stop harassing me, and to act like an adult, and that seemed to work for about an hour. After that, he messaged me back, and said he would get me for what I had done. I sent him a message asking what he was talking about, and you will not believe what he told me back. He said I had disrespected his father, Dracula, and how we Van Helsings were weak and the only thing I was good for was bearing his father's children, if I even got that lucky. So at that point, I honestly thought it was some troll or joke, and they were just taking it too far. Until he sent me another message, threatening me, using my real name and my address. That's when I had enough. This guy actually thought I was freaking Van Helsing or something, which I am not. So after that, I deleted my account, and I still haven't created another. I'm debating on whether or not to even create another one. Before I end this story, I have one final thing to say. To the creepy guy that called me all those harsh things, who believes that I'm part of a Van Helsing family line and that he's Dracula's son, Vladimir, or whatever your real name is, if you ever get the chance to see or hear this, please get some help, and I hope I never meet you in person. Number 3. The Tall Figure. Submitted by Andrew C. I was 15 at the time of this story, and I lived in the rural suburbs of Pennsylvania. There is a large pine and oak forest near my house, and I would regularly hunt and camp there with my friends. One night on such an occasion, my friend Nick and I were camping on a winter hunting trip deep into that forest. I had left the tents to do my business in the woods. After I walked out a good distance away from the campsite, I heard a low-toned humming sound. I ignored the sound, thinking that my mind was playing tricks on me. As I finished my business and was making my way back, I heard the snow around me start to crunch, as if something of substantial weight was moving on it. Living in this area my whole life, I knew that at this time of year, nothing big enough to crush the snow like that was awake or around. I slowly and as silently as possible got back to camp, and for safety I picked up my rifle and waited. About 2 hours passed, and it was nearly pitch black outside. I was tired, but I finally heard the terrible crunching sound again. I quickly readied my rifle for whoever or whatever this thing was, and when I saw it, I nearly dropped my gun. I was fully expecting another person, or at least a bear that hadn't been hibernating or something, but what I saw was straight from a nightmare. It was large, pale, and lanky. Its mouth was covered in blood. The creature was just barely illuminated by my gas lamp. Its eyes were a piercing orange. At least 60 seconds passed of me looking at this thing, before it finally took notice of me, as if it knew I was nervous or scared. It smiled at me. I know it sounds crazy, but this thing, it smiled, and it began to slink back into the woods. To say the obvious, I didn't sleep that night. I held onto my rifle, waiting and watching. The next morning, I told Nick about what happened. He laughed at me like a good friend would and said we should pack up and just go home. The worst part of it, though, was that as we were pulling out of the clearing our car was parked in, I looked back nearly asleep, and I swear to God I saw those same eyes staring at me, orange and piercing. I share my story now to let anyone know, if you're going into the woods, be sure to bring something to protect yourself. You do not want to end up being the next missing person or mutilated body. Number 4. The Thing in the Fields, Vampire or Fiend. Submitted by Nikki Real. This happened around last July. Me and my friends, including my boyfriend, are all big paranormal junkies. We go out all the time searching for anything. Creatures, ghosts. We've went to cemeteries at night, heard little girls laughing in the woods at 3 in the morning. We saw a completely black dog that stood a good 5 feet off the ground. But what we saw last summer, I was not prepared for, and I've never seen anything like it. My boyfriend, let's call him Chris, had just finished working on our friend Jake's ruckus. So afterwards, we decided to hang out and head to Azalea, a known haunted place around Indiana. A mother dropped her baby off the bridge there, then killed herself. Creatures roam around, a slave will appear every once in a while hanging from the oak tree by the road. There's a ton of different weird stories and sightings reported there. But Chris, Jake, and Chris's brother Drew, along with myself, decided it'd be a great place to visit. It was warm, a clear night, and gorgeous. We got in Chris's car and headed out. It was only a few minutes away, so it didn't take long before we turned the curve and headed toward the first bridge, awaiting the second bridge that the lady jumped from. Chris and I rolled our windows down and lit 2 cigarettes. We didn't see anything coming over the first bridge, but once we got on the stretch of road, I looked toward the field, freshly cut. I could see pretty far out with the moon overhead. "Chris," I said. "Yeah?" he said, curious. I pointed out to the field. At first, I could have mistaken it for a dog, but then I concentrated more. As I had gotten Chris's attention, it had drawn the other 2 guys' attention as well. Chris slowed the vehicle down, much to my dismay. Whatever this was, it was terrifying to behold. It was humanoid with long, thin arms and muscular, long legs. It was keeping up with the car. A weird growl escaped from its throat as it charged at us. The whole time, Chris was taunting the thing and not moving. I cried out, and I begged him to move. And as soon as it looked like it was going to lunge at our window, Chris finally threw the car into gear and raced ahead. I watched as this thing disappeared under the bridge. I sighed in relief. Maybe it wouldn't pass the bridge. But I was wrong. It barreled from under the bridge into my side of the car. Drew and Jake were breathing heavily and watching out the back window. Every once in a while, I could feel Jake's body shake with fear. We turned onto the highway and drove towards home, hoping to lose whatever that was on the highway. By the time we pulled into Chris's driveway, we unloaded from the car and Chris ran inside. I swallowed a lump in my throat and chuckled as Chris walked out, gun in hand. "We lost it. It's not around." I was so happy. My heartbeat was still fast and my hands clammy. But you know that feeling when you're being watched? How you begin to sweat and get cold chills. Your hair stands up on end. All at once, we all got that feeling. I looked up towards the woods behind Chris's house. A field was connected to the back of it. The woods there aren't very large, just a few trees and bushes so we could see the other side. And I realized we hadn't lost it after all. We all watched as it walked out from the woods. I felt like crying and scrabbled on top of the car, watching this thing. Chris aimed his gun at it, and it made no movement, like it was going to attack. In fact, it looked more curious. If it wanted to, it could have killed us all that night. We finally calmed down until we noticed it had brought another one with it. The creatures would walk in and out of the shadows, like predators watching for an opening to attack its prey. I could see yellow eyes and pale skin. At one point, I caught the glimmer of sharp fangs on either side of its mouth, and their ears appeared to be pointed. I've never seen anything like that before in my life. Call us stupid, but all of us at once began to move forward, to get closer. Curiosity got the better of us. We made it up the middle of the house before the things moved into the shadows. At this point, they were only about 40 feet ahead of us. I felt more horrified than I'd ever been. We all walked back slowly, never turning around. Finally, we went to the car and just waited. It must have been around 4 in the morning when they finally stopped coming out of the shadows. Jake decided it was time to go home. He left, while Chris and I went inside and hung out in his bedroom. But all night I heard scraping at the windows and knocks on the walls. It was terrible. I haven't seen them since. We've been back to Azalea but never seen them. I've heard growls, but that's about it. Maybe because it's winter. Maybe it's just because they wanted to get a better look at us. But whatever they were, I truly would have hated to meet them by myself. Number 5. I Believe in Vampires. Submitted by M.M. Costanza. My name is Matt. I'm 38 years old and I believe in vampires. When I was a kid, vampires were thought to be pale creatures wearing black capes. They lived in castles and turned into bats. Yeah, I'm from the 70s and 80s generations. Today's idea of a vampire is much different, either thought to be monsters disguised as men who hunt and kill amongst us, or the romantic, misunderstood people that fight the urge to kill and live on the blood of animals. I believe they're more like today's idea of vampires. After my marriage of 10 years ended, I began to online date. I couldn't seem to meet anyone that I could become truly interested in here in my own small hometown. So I took to the internet for love. I became friends and even went out with a few different women, but no one was as interesting as Claire. She was a 35-year-old zoologist from Alaska. I'm from California, so that was a great distance from which to try and have a relationship. But when I saw her picture online, her eyes intrigued me. They were almost the color of an amethyst, and she had beautiful auburn hair. Looks are not the most important thing in a relationship, but let's be honest, that is what gets your attention at first. I hit her up for a conversation, and much to my surprise, she replied almost instantly. I'm not a bad-looking guy, but there are hundreds of guys online she could have talked to rather than me. For 2 weeks, I spent my entire evening after work talking to her until I just had to go to bed. We talked about everything from our careers to our past relationships. I soon decided that distance or not, we had to meet. I asked her the next evening how she felt about me booking a flight for the next week. That's when things got really, really weird. For the first time in ages, she didn't answer right away, but when she did, it was not what I expected. She told me that she had a sort of anemic blood disorder that kept her from going outside during the day, because if it was too bright a day, the sunlight could make her very sick and nauseous. She said she hadn't been outside during the day in many years. She said she would have been honest up front, but didn't see us ever being anything more than friends online because of the distance. This was definitely a problem, but I just wanted to be with someone I connected to, and I definitely felt a connection here. I told her I didn't care, that I wanted to see her face to face, and just see where it went from there. She didn't reply after that, so I waited a few hours, and I tried to call the number she had given me. I had to call several times before she finally answered. She apologized and said it was not going to work with us, because there was so much more that I did not know or understand. And no matter how much I asked, she wouldn't tell me. I didn't know what she was talking about. I told her I was coming anyway, because I felt we had something special. She begged me not to come. She said that she and her sisters lived with their father, and that he was a very hard and controlling man, and that if I came, bad things would happen. I felt more than ever that I needed to go. I guess I had this hero complex, thinking that I had to save her from this unknown evil man. This situation I'm just now hearing about. She had told me the small town she lived in. That I won't mention, and with such a small population, I was sure I could find her without an address. So, I booked a flight for the following week. When the day of my flight arrived, I woke excited and ready for my great adventure. It was a long flight, and I had to change planes 3 times. The last plane was one of those little twin-engine planes that I had only seen in movies. But I couldn't sleep because I was anxious, and I couldn't stop planning on how to handle what was going to happen next. I was excited. I was nervous. When my flight landed, I thought it would take forever to get into town. The temperatures and snow made the roads horrible, but the driver was a local and made it there without a problem. I asked him if he knew of Claire and her family. I even showed him a picture that I had printed off before leaving home. He said that she looked very familiar, but he told me to stop at the general store where all the locals get their supplies. I only had to ask one person, the store owner, if they knew her, and luckily I got immediate results. They said that she lived with her family a few miles outside of town, and even offered me a ride. After another short yet still cold and slippery road trip, I found myself standing in front of this beautiful 2-story cabin in the woods. It was like a scene from a Christmas card. I got out and approached the house while my driver waited. I climbed the steps nervously, and I knocked on the door. But there was no reply. I waited, and then I knocked 2 more times. There was a light on in the front room, but no one seemed to be home. I mean, they hadn't exactly been expecting me, so I thought I would go back into town and get a room and come back tomorrow. I came all this way after all. On the way back to the store, I asked the driver if there was a motel in town. He said no, but they had 2 rooms behind the store that they rented out when the daylight came back. Comes back, I said, and then he explained to me. I had happened to show up during the latter part of the year where the sun only stays up a few minutes every day, so most of the time it was dark out. When we got back to the store, the owner said that she remembered something while I had been out. She said that this particular family is only there during the darkness. They have a kind of backwards vacation stay during the dark part every year. They arrive early in the season and leave right before daylight returns. She said they're quiet and they always keep to themselves. She giggled a little bit and told me that the locals call them the Vampire Family. I didn't find this funny, especially considering Claire's disorder. And on top of disappointment, I was already getting freaked out. I stayed the night in one of the little back rooms and took 1 more trip out to the house that evening, but had to hurry because there was a storm coming and I would have to catch a flight out to beat it. The house was still silent, and now it felt rather creepy. So now with my heart aching and a mystery hanging over the whole thing, I headed back to my warm home. I'll be honest, I was a bit depressed after that. I had been messaging Claire from the time I made it to Alaska until I got home, but there was never a reply. I had been home for almost a week when I got the last message I would ever get from Claire. The message read, "I told you not to come. My father would kill you and I would be severely punished. What the locals like to laugh at isn't a joke, but it's true. I'm so sorry for the pain I've caused." And number 6, High School Freak, submitted by Gomez. Chad was the weirdest and most insane person I'd ever met in my life. He was the new kid when I was a junior in high school. He was quiet, abnormally tall, and thin. Chad had long black dyed hair and straightened his hair every day. The guy was freaky enough to look at. Now, I didn't want to be that douchebag that judged a person based on what they look like. Everyone has their own style and taste, so I tried not to think any more of it. Anyway, Chad ended up in my psychology class. The class had desks placed in rows of 4. And he happened to sit on the opposite end of the row, so that we were both placed on either end of it. Every day he wouldn't say a word. He just sat there hunched at his desk, hair covering his face. Every once in a while he would take something from a black bag at the side of his desk and sip at it. Then he would take a wet nap and wipe his mouth. I swear to God I saw traces of red on the napkin. Yes, this guy weirded me out enough that I glanced over at him a little more than I should have. One day he came up to me during lunch, as I often ate by myself. He sat next to me and said, "You want to try some?" "What? What are you talking about? Dude, I don't even know you," I replied. I could barely see him smile under his hair. He took something out of that black bag of his and squirted it all over the table in front of me. It was a little thick and dark red. Apparently, it was supposed to look like blood, and I could hear him laugh. What the heck, man? I was irritated that he had just spilled that crap in front of me. Just try it. I've seen you watching me drink it, he insisted. Then he took a big long gulp of the nasty-looking stuff. Dude, get away from me. He shook his head and walked away. Now, what I did next was pretty stupid, but I was beyond curious. I tapped the liquid with my finger and tasted it. I gagged almost immediately. I was expecting a sweet taste, probably some fruit juice made to look like blood. Maybe it was some sort of new gothic thing. But when I tasted it, it was bitter and metallic. It tasted exactly like blood. What kind of person is drinking blood and where did he get it? I got my stuff and began to walk to the front office of the school. I was going to tell the principal about this weirdo. But I stopped. Firstly, what was I going to say? That some kid was supposedly drinking blood? Secondly, I saw the freak watching me and drinking from that same bottle. So instead, I went early to my next class. Luckily, things kinda worked out in the end. Because a few months later, the guy just stopped coming to school. Apparently, Chad was arrested after stabbing his neighbor's dog to death. I'm glad he's gone, and it pains me to wonder how long he's been drinking blood, and where he's been getting it at this whole time. There are all kinds of weird and scary things in this world. People can be freaky and obsessive, threatening others to fulfill their sickening desires. There are animals out there that are rare and terrifying to behold, that escape into the caves and dark and come out only at night when we can't see them. Whether we like it or not, things exist around us that want to tear down our lives, or at the very least, rip out our throats. Good night. Be sure to like, share, comment, and subscribe if you enjoyed the video. And don't forget to send us your Jersey Devil sightings and McDonald's or Walmart encounters. Thanks.